When it comes to the situation in Sweden, I would say that it's fairly stable right now. We have a slight change in the epidemiology. As I said last time, I think so far the epidemic has been very much concentrated to Stockholm, our most densely populated area, and the densely populated surrounding regions, and not so much of an epidemic in the rest of the country. The epidemic in Stockholm is clearly slowing down. We have considerably fewer admissions to ICU. The mortality rates are coming down. We had an average of almost 100 cases a day for a while. Now we're down to slightly more than 70. The number of people in hospitals are slowly diminishing, even if the stress on healthcare is still very, very big. And the healthcare in Sweden has done an enormous job in keeping up with this. Instead, we see a slight difference in especially Gothenburg, where there is some kind of increase of cases, not very great. While the south of Sweden remains fairly calm, which is interesting because in Copenhagen, just across the water, they have quite a lot of spread of the disease. I think once again shows us how unpredictable this disease is in many ways. We are working very hard with our elderly homes. We think we had some kind of success, that it seems like the cases in those elderly homes are slowly diminishing. We know that many of the people working there are doing lots of things to improve the situation and diminish the spread in those homes. We're also looking at the level of immunity in the population here, and we have now a number of smaller studies have been made recently. We have done some modeling around those and adding those data, and we think that we are reaching maybe a quarter of the population in the Stockholm region have had the disease by now. And we do believe that part of the reason why the epidemic is slowing down here is that we're having a considerable part of the population is now immune, we believe. We are doing a major investigation about the immunity in the Stockholm area and also the whole of Sweden during this week, and the laboratory results will be available hopefully by the end of next week, and then we'll know a little bit better. But still a lot of stress. The death toll is, of course, devastating, and not at all acceptable. But in other areas, I think we see slight improvements enough for us to feel that the summer will be reasonable in Sweden, we hope. First of all, we can of course discuss who is orthodox and who is unorthodox. Are the people closing down their society completely, which has probably never been done before, more or less orthodox than Sweden, who is doing what we usually do in public health, giving a lot of responsibility to the population, trying to install a dialogue with the population and achieve good results with that. I think what has kept us on this path is a couple of things. One of the things that we can really measure that people have followed our advice very much. We can tell that the travel patterns have changed very much. We actually made a comparison to our Nordic neighbors, and the Swedish travel patterns have changed just as much as any of our Nordic neighbors, in spite of them having much more legal lockdowns than we have. For Easter, Swedes travel only 10% of what they normally travel. We also know that train traffic is down to like 20% of normal. We know that traffic in Stockholm, the collective traffic, is much, much less than it used to be. So people are working from home a lot. People are staying home a lot. And so it really had an impact what we are trying to people to do. And the other thing is that we actually, the healthcare services have kept on functioning at a very good level. There has always been empty beds. Nobody has ever been denied treatment in any way. Everybody has received the same level of treatment that they would normally do. So that's the other thing that kept us on this task. The one thing that's made us wondering is the death toll in the elderly homes. And then you have to realize that the elderly homes we are talking about, that's about 70,000 people above 70 who live in those, sort of 1.5 million people above 70 in Sweden. So it's only a very small group of people. And these are the people in Sweden who are the eldest and most sick people in Sweden. So this is, we're really talking here facilities for long-term care. And that's where we had a high death toll, a big problem with the introduction of the disease into those. Now we, and especially the regions who are running these homes, the communities that are running these homes, are installing a number of measures. And we see that there is a slight improvement. And I think that can take care of that negative thing. We had a high death toll in the community. So I think all in all, we can see that our voluntary way had in very many ways the same kind of effect that the legal ways of closing down had in many other countries. And I think that's what kept us going on this way. And not least the very high level of confidence from the population. We have made repeated surveys, and not only us, also many other agencies. And the agency now has about 80% approval rating in any kind of survey we do. If people are worried, they are worried about the economy. Only like 5-10% are worried about that we're not taking the right kind of measures in the health area. So we feel quite confident that we have the population behind us, and they accept what we're doing and think that we're doing the right thing. So Brazil is vulnerable because it is in the part of the world where, you know, experience winter. And I think even if the science is not very strong on this, the spread of the virus favors winter time, I would say, even if we don't really know for sure. But I think there's a lot to say for that. So, of course, you are getting the introduction of this disease during an unfavorable time of the year, and that will work against you. And as somebody said, you have some very densely populated urban areas. And we also know from many parts of the world that those areas are very susceptible to the spread of the disease. So yes, I think at least in the Southern Hemisphere, Brazil might be one of the countries that's going to be hardest hit. That's quite possible. No, I mean, as you said, we worked a lot with trying to keep social distancing because we really do believe that's probably the most efficient thing you can do. If you have less social contacts, especially close social contacts for some extended amount of time, I think what we know about the disease, that's the real risk part of it. I mean, which means that in families, in the workplace, restaurants in the evenings, those kind of places where you spend considerable amount of time sitting very close to each other, that's the situations when you have most of the spread. And that's also where we really try to work on having restrictions and getting voluntary, minimizing by voluntary measures the spread in those areas. Many countries now have instituted these very strict lockdowns. They realize that this is not a sustainable measure. And I think one of the reasons why we've chosen, the way we have chosen in Sweden is really sustainability. Because we know that we're going to have to deal with this disease for a long time, probably several years into the future, before we can get some kind of normality around it. And I think that then there is a truth. I mean, different countries can then look to Sweden and say, okay, these and these things you can avoid, you can not do, and you can still have a sustainable situation. I think schools are one of the examples. I think we have shown that schools have a very small effect on the spread of the disease, and closing schools is not the magic bullet that you would use. Instead, schools might have a lot of negative consequences, domestic violence, children not being able to finalize their education, which is, at least in the Swedish setting, extremely important for their future and those kind of things. So I think there are things that the Swedish example might be for other countries to show them, okay, these are the kind of things that we can now lift our sanctions against. And I think we see that already when a number of countries in Europe are actually choosing schools as one of the first parts of their exit strategies. As you know, high schools and universities have gone to distance learning in Sweden. That's also something we might look at, because that might not be all that important anymore to do that on distance. Maybe we can see them coming back together without too many effects. And I think that's the way to go forward, to look at the risk of different things and then slowly opening one thing up after the other.
And Sweden has become even more known for this concept of herd immunity. But of course, up to now, there has not been a scientific proof that even people which were infected before cannot get reinfected again. So how can we possibly talk about herd immunity?
I think we need to think about it in two different ways. I mean, the immunity of an individual is still unclear. So to test individuals and say that you will never have this disease again, no, we cannot do that yet. We don't know what kind of tests to do and how to look at those tests. When it comes to the immunity in populations, I think most of the experts are quite in agreement. Yes, there will be a kind of immunity in a population. We don't know the exact level. We don't know for how long it will last, but it will be there. I mean, we can measure all of the classical signs of immunity, higher levels of antibodies and all those kind of things. So, and we do have had extremely few, if any, cases of documented second infections in people who have had disease before. During this, all of these cases in Sweden, we have had almost 30,000 cases over a 3 month period. Not one single person have had the disease twice. And as you know, we have a very good system in Sweden with personal identifiers. So we will definitely catch even a single case of somebody having the disease twice, and we have not seen anything like that in our registers. So I know that there is a lot of unknowns in this, but I think we overestimate the unknowns because there is so much information from other diseases, information from what we have already have, saying that we might not have a complete herd immunity. Herd immunity will definitely not make the disease go away, but the immunity in the population will slow down the spread quite a lot and make it much more sustainable to keep our vulnerable populations safe and keep our healthcare services working. I think Sweden as a whole has a lesson to learn when it comes to the quality of care in our elderly homes. And I think among a number of things we'll discuss after this pandemic, quality of care in our elderly homes will be one of the big issues, that I'm sure. Now, I think for most countries, the really central part about it is to have a working health system. And if you have a health system that's not very well prepared or already slightly overwhelmed, I can understand that going for a lockdown is something that's very tempting and something that maybe need to be done to save time. Because I think you need to realize that locking down is saving time. It's not solving anything. We can see now that our neighboring countries have about 1% of the population who has been infected so far. We have maybe 20-25%, which means they have a long way to go before they would get any kind of help from an immunity in the population in controlling the disease, which means that they're going to have a lot of measures in place for a long, long time. But given that saving times is something you really need to do to prepare your health services so that they are really on as high level of alert as possible, and then maybe opening up slowly, easily, to sort of try to gauge where you can be and your health services still keep on working. And that's going to be very tricky and something all European countries now are fighting with. But here in Brazil might be lucky. There's going to be, I think, quite a lot of experience to learn from Europe and the different countries opening up now, to give some kind of clues to okay, what can you start with without too many ill effects, and how quickly can you move to opening up different parts of the society without having a health service that's going to be overwhelmed. Yeah, I mean, to a certain extent, but not completely, because I don't think that kind of isolation really would work. And we have seen that in Sweden too.